Hello and welcome to Tar Heel Teachers at Home. I'm Marlo Artis and I'm the moderator of the program. Tar Heel Teachers at Home is a video cast focused on engaging North Carolinians in conversations around education. Each week I'm happily joined by a wonderful panel of educators, each one representing a particular subsection of education. We'll start our introductions with our elementary school panelists.
Good evening, everyone. I am Dia Collins-Thomas. I am a principal in Bladen County at Bladen Lakes Primary School. I've been an educator for just about 18 years, 17 and a half to be exact. My Twitter handle is @educatorDThomas, and I'm excited to be joining tonight.
And we're so glad, Cassandra, if you could just hold one second. We're so glad to have Dia on. Those of you who are longtime viewers of Tar Heel Teachers will remember Dia as our original high school panelist, and she has gone on to be a strong administrator in Bladen County, and so we're really glad to have her on as our special guest co-host for elementary. And our regular elementary panelist, Amy, is out, and we're really excited because she just had her baby, so we're really excited on these days.
Well, hello, my name is Cassandra Parsons, and I work at Spring Lake Middle School at Cumberland County Schools, and you can follow me at CParsonsEC.
Hello, my name is Micah Tweetmeyer. I'm a biology teacher at Riverside High School in Durham, and you can follow me on Twitter at Micah J. Hunter.
Hello, everyone. My name is Arisha Small, and I'm the elementary AIG program specialist for Cumberland County Schools, and you can follow me on Twitter at Smalls Arisha.
And for this special episode of Tar Heel Teachers at Home, we are chatting about COVID-19. We're talking around ways that we can help manage the stress and anxiety that teachers and students may be feeling around this time, and we're really excited to have two special guests on the program to have this discussion with us. We have Dr. Amy Parker, who is the Director of Counseling Services for Gaston County Schools. She's also the President-Elect for the North Carolina School Counselor Association. And we also have Caron Nowell, who on the program, who is the President of the North Carolina School Psychology Association. So we're very excited about having these individuals on this program to lend their perspective around managing stress and anxiety as it relates to the coronavirus. Thank you both so much for joining us on Tar Heel Teachers at Home.
Thank you for inviting me.
It's great to be here.
Thank you both so much. We appreciate you, Lynn, and your expertise. So how are you all managing your own personal feelings around this topic? Because in order to support your constituents that you're serving, other educators and students that you serve, how do you manage your own feelings around this topic?
Well, that's a good question. I think that, you know, as adults, we need to reflect a calm and steady attitude and approach to it, because certainly our kids pick up where we're at with our feelings and our emotions and our anxieties. And so one of the things that I do too is I just keep listening to what are the basic things that the experts are really asking us to do. Washing my hands, fist bumping. A lot of times I was joking around with the kids and just doing a fist bump, and they kind of find that as fun and cool. But definitely using the hand sanitizer and just following some basic practices and kind of modeling sort of a calm and structured way to approach it, I guess you would say, by following just some basic, simple guides that have been set out for us.
And I would add to that, from my perspective, I've certainly self-care, definitely making sure you're taking time out to exercise or to and spend time with family, but also making sure that you have good facts and good information and that you can share that effectively with students, faculty, families that may reach out to the schools, so that we are providing information, not only what we can provide about the virus, but also about our response to it and how we're there to support them.
That's great. because, you know, there's so many different pieces. You hear so much from the media. And so sometimes individuals can have an overload. We're managing the response that schools have been tasked with in terms of providing online resources for students and the food needs and managing food insecurities. And also educators are thinking about pay and compensation. Like, how are we going to be paid and compensated during this time? How are we going to manage our schedule? So there's so many different thoughts that are actually going through everyone's mind during this time. So self-care is extremely important. What questions do we have for Amy and Caron?
I don't have a question just yet, but I do have a comment or something I'd like to share with everyone, the viewers and the and our guests, that recently I posted on Twitter, or I retweeted something on Twitter, and it was called, I have to look at my phone, I want to get the title just right. It was from NPR.org, and it was called Just for Kids, a comic exploring the new coronavirus. Did you guys have a chance to see that? If you haven't, check it out, because the day that I'm not in the classroom anymore, but the morning that I saw that and reposted, I was thinking, if I was in the classroom, it was the perfect thing to just start the day with. Like, pull it up, let's talk about it, let's answer some questions, let's get rid of the misconceptions about it, because it is a scary time for kids, but it's also a scary time for adults when you just don't understand all the details about what's happening.
That is an excellent resource. That's actually something we've been working on. We had a work day today in my district, but a lot of the school counselors were sharing resources. That was definitely a resource that was shared, and trying to get information out there to families so that they know how to talk to their children about it. And I think that's a great way, or maybe a family isn't as comfortable. That's a great introduction to where they could watch it together and then a discussion could follow. I think it's a great resource.
And I think it's important to keep in mind developmentally where kids are. I think for the younger kids, sort of letting them guide the discussion about, you know, the questions that they ask, rather than giving an overload of information. Just thinking about, again, middle schoolers can take information in a different way than elementary school kids, than high school kids who read more about it. And so, you know, using those good resources and developmentally figuring out what works best for kids to understand and sort of allay their fears in a language they can understand is helpful too.
And I agree. And I think that's why the comic was good, because we know scholars of the day or kids of the day like the comics. So you bring up the comic, they may not start reading it right away, but you know, comics have that specific look to it. Oh, we got a comic going on. And then you start the discussion. Oh, it's a serious discussion, but they're more eager to learn from it because it's something they're interested in.
Something else I liked about that particular resource is that when you guys get an opportunity to look at it, it's not like a comic like Spider-Man, Superman, where it's super professionally done. It looks like a student could have created it. It's almost like, oh, one of my peers could have done this, and the kids could do many extensions off of that. I just think all around it would be a great resource. It is a great resource.
It is. And we're going to make sure that we have the link for that comic in the description box for this episode.
So I've heard Dr. Oz talk about healthy eating and some vitamins. Do you know anything about the vitamins you can take that's supposed to help with your immune system?
I don't specifically know some. I've heard about zinc, I think was one, but that's kind of not my area of expertise. Somebody else maybe know or read an article about that.
I didn't read an article about it, but I have vitamin C. You know, just naturally, we always try to keep vitamin C in our body. So when I don't have orange juice, vitamin C sits on the top of my refrigerator. Okay, here I come.
And I would think related to that, just healthy habits in general. I know, you know, in the schools we have certain rules about students getting enough exercise and recess, or just getting outside, that natural vitamin D of being in the sunshine and getting outside during a time when they're not in structured activities at the schools. I think that was very helpful as well.
That is. I've actually thought a lot about this, because I'm guilty of really thinking that I need to just stay in my house and not go anywhere and do anything. But because my grandma lives with me and she's 77, but it is okay for us to take a ride and kind of get some fresh air and those types of things, because we're not you know, we're not diagnosed with the coronavirus, and so we're not going to put each other in any more risk than we would if we were sitting in our homes, if we're together driving in the car. And so that's something that I've really been thinking about, so that you don't feel so confined just to your home, that you are doing things that are healthy and allowable outdoors.
And I think that's important as we are talking about ways to kind of get through this unique situation we're in. You know, the kids, the scholars are not at school, and they won't be at school for 2 weeks. And so, you know, if they have a backyard or a front yard, it's okay to go out in that backyard and, like she said, get the vitamin D or play. You know, there's so many little things, because they always want to be on the games, the gaming systems now, or on their iPads or tablets. And now that they're home and there's digital resources being sent for them to keep learning, you know, now is the perfect time for them to learn on those digital devices. And then when it's time to take a break, go outside and take a break. It's warming up a little bit, as long as they don't have allergies, because, you know, the pollen will tear somebody.
Well, yes, my daughter is, she's paranoid. I opened the window just to get some fresh air, and I went back in the kitchen. She closed it. And I said, why'd you close the window? And she says, because I don't want the coronavirus coming through the house. So it is not airborne unless you're within so many feet from another person, right?
Right.
And so that's all about, you know, getting rid of those myths. You know, right. there's the right information out there, and then there's the wrong information. And I think this is a great episode to help make sure that the right information is getting out.
Mm-hmm. And Dia, you were talking about, you know, the kids should be outside and getting fresh air and exercise. And I saw something on one of the social media outlets that someone posted a schedule of, okay, this yes. is what you can do with the kids. You know, you're outside taking a walk for this long and do this for. And I think that's great, because some parents don't know where to begin. Even before the coronavirus, I was just thinking, I have 2 6-year-olds there in kindergarten now, but this summer will actually be, and I'm almost embarrassed to admit this, but I'm a working mom. So this summer is actually going to be the first time since they were infants that we've been at home, like alone together, like me not working in the summer and them not in daycare or camp. And, you know, I have that teacher background, so I know how to schedule a day, but there are some parents that's just not how they live their day-to-day life, and they're not exactly sure what to put on the schedule for their kids for this time that they're at home.
And it might just be worth noting that none of us on this panel right now are physicians or medical doctors. So with regards yes. to mm-hmm. suggesting any sort of vitamins or anything like that. And also, you know, a recommendation is not to have play dates or to go into other people's houses. And I think mm-hmm. that's, you know, I teach high school and they're so social. I mean, all students are social. But this idea of being isolated in everybody's houses, probably for longer than 2 weeks. And just a lot of my students have been reaching out, you know, all their fun senior year activities are getting canceled, mm-hmm. you know, prom, field trips, senior fest. And just this idea of all the things that they had been looking forward to for 4 years are probably not going to happen. And, you know, colleges aren't even happening right now. So kind of an unsure, you know, what it's going to look like when we re-enter and everyone gets back together again is going to be really different as well. So I think, I know a lot of teachers have been worried about the academics, and ultimately, eventually we'll worry about the academics, but I think a lot of our students are just concerned for their families, and they have jobs that are now no longer asking them to come to work. And I think everybody has a sense of fear that I think it's just good to acknowledge that everybody's a little bit afraid.
Mm-hmm. Which makes it difficult for us to have our learning brain to be as functional as it typically would be if it wasn't a pandemic. So I want educators to really be mindful of that as we are sending out online homework and instruction. It's wonderful for us to have that as a resource, but we do have to monitor screen time, and we also have to just be mindful of the fact that individuals are aware of a lot of different things right now, and schoolwork is on the list, but it's not the only thing that's on the list. And so if we're mindful of that, I think it could be helpful. And I also think it could be helpful that as a state, if we move to go ahead and cancel the standardized testing for this year, I think that could also help to ease some of the anxiety that some of our educators may be feeling.
So we were told that the work that we're sending, the packets they're sending out, is only for enhancement, enrichment, but not to grade it. So I like that part. They have taken that that stress off of the students, because some students we know are going to be babysitters. And some students, although I know Spectrum is supposed to be making sure that they have the free internet, it's still a progressive thing. And so I'm glad that they looked at it at that perspective, that we're not going to bombard them with having to get this work done for grades, and they're not getting the proper instruction. So
yeah, we have that same directive as well, to make sure that it's a reinforcement activities and things that they've covered already to support educational and what they're doing, and really no new material for them as well. So I too appreciate their awareness that, you know, I think the other thing is parents, you know, a lot of us are working from home now. And so having the kids and having to work from home, you know, is all pretty stressful. So I appreciate the schools, you know, putting together information so that they are really still doing some instructional activities and kind of keeping a schedule and a routine. And I think that's really crucial at this point as well, is that families keep just kind of the routines that they normally keep, even when they're in school, getting up, you know, having breakfast, then they spend time working, mom or dad can spend time working, lunch break. Just a good daily routine, I think, is really helpful to kind of allay some fears as well.
I think that's a great suggestion. I also will say that I had not thought about this until I started looking into it a little bit more today to try to put some things together for the school counselors. And one of the things I read was, like, don't have the media on constantly. I know we all want the updates, but even for the children that are in the home, just hearing that repetition so much can raise their anxiety and their worry so much, and in our own, without us realizing it. So, you know, just really being cognizant of how much media we are consuming, and, you know, taking a break from it, I guess.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's a great point.
Mm-hmm.
That's a great point. What other thoughts do we have around this?
Well, as I just scratched my nose because it was itching, just a reminder to try to keep your hands off of your face. You know,
mm-hmm.
I think that's one of the big things. And for those of us that use our hands, it's really hard. But that's just a reminder, as I just had to scratch my nose.
Yeah.
I'm also hoping that all of the practices that we're so big on now because of the time that we're in, I hope that we keep them whenever we do re-enter school. I know that when I used to line my kids up for lunch, we had hand sanitizer before we went to the cafeteria. I hope that continues to be a common practice. And just keeping the tables and things clean. And I know this all sounds like simple stuff, but if we're not training our kids to do these things, they're not just going to do them on their own. And I know that's something that Marlo and I had talked about before the show, is that we have kids have to be trained so that they know what to do. We can't just expect them to know.
That's a good point.
I was thinking about that too. For a lot of years, we've been teaching kids to sneeze into their elbow. And now they're, you know, really kind of training them now to really sneeze into a tissue and put that in the trash right away, because the elbow, you know, isn't really going to protect as well as really having a barrier between their sneeze, whatever. And so that was one of the things that I thought about. We're going to have to sort of retrain the kids to say, you know, just grab a tissue, you know, you're going to sneeze. And just reminding, like you said, about keeping some of those healthy cleaning things, the sanitizer, all of that. Yeah.
Well, and if you think about
is banking, Kleenex and Germix and all of these places. Yeah. I forgot which news outlet it was, but they had the state of New York had created their own hand sanitizer that is supposed to be like a superior grade than what's on the market, and they're giving it away for free in their state. So now I wonder if they're gonna start distributing their own tissues or masks or gloves or whatever. It's a strange time that we're living in.
Yeah. So Amy and Caron, what are your thoughts and recommendations regarding some of our students who teachers already know had some anxiety, anxiety inducing behaviors already, and who are already very anxious in general in terms of still being able to support them during this time where we're not able to be together face to face?
Sure. I think that's so important. First of all, what we did, because I know many districts have some form of school-based therapy or students who are already diagnosed or getting treatment. And so, really spent some time today reaching out to our agencies to see what options there are available for either telehealth or meetings at the agencies, or even one of our agencies is going to make home visits if they feel comfortable doing that. So, just providing that continued service for those students who needed it already. And then for those who are experiencing anxiety, just making sure that they have some coping skills. We do some mental health awareness programs throughout the year. We were just getting ready to have one just before spring break, anticipating that being away from your, supports at school. So we've tried to put some of that online, just posting some coping skills, some things that families can help their students with. And knowing what their resources are if they need to reach out for those who are not already connected to mental health supports. So just trying to make sure that information is available to them. But a lot of just, reminding them that just teaching the students to breathe, to use different breathing techniques. And I talked a little bit about exercise earlier, but yoga and different things like that, that they can do as a family. Mm-hmm. And Caron, I'm sure you have some other ideas.
Oh, I think you hit the really top-notch good ones. We've kind of talked about too is, our counselors and psychologists know some of our more vulnerable students, and we're looking at platforms that are HIPAA and FERPA protected so that we could make some contact with those more vulnerable students that we know about. And like you said, providing them some coping strategies and ways that they can kind of manage their anxiety about it. We would say exercise, diet, those kinds of things, some breathing, some relaxation training kinds of things that can easily be accessed even on some online apps to refer them to. I know we recommend, there's different platforms that you can find and apps that will help with just some progressive relaxation and reminding that there are some things that we don't have control over, but there are things that you do have control over, and that's how you manage your stress and your anxiety and the messages that you're telling yourself about, what's going to happen. And just giving that reassurance. And I think too that, kids have different, personalities. And so some may become more quiet, some may become more talkative. And so as a parent or a teacher or a psychologist, nurse, just kind of tuning into those signs, because some kids might not come up and say to you, gee, I'm really worried, or be able to express what's happening with them and may be more withdrawn or quiet. And so I think parents recognizing that, and then if they feel like their student needs more help, contacting, perhaps the school. We're all still kind of putting up some systems about how that might work. This is an unusual circumstance to know for sure what to do to get those. But I really concur with a lot of the great ideas that you said there too, and for us just watching those more vulnerable kids that we already kind of know about.
I would say too, this is such a great opportunity for social emotional learning, just those character traits of being kind and being respectful and listening skills and just things like that that the families can discuss and can, you know, bring that out in their education as well, not just the academic pieces and the enhancement we're sending back, but, you know, those social emotional learning and that can be very effective.
Right. So, yeah, I think one other piece that I read too is, you know, teaching kids about just not blaming who's responsible for the virus or a certain group of people or, you know, making sure that we're not trying to blame a certain group or folks about the virus and how it started or any of that, that entertaining any of that.
Yes, that's really important. And also I think it's wonderful that Star Commonwealth has provided a free coupon, if you will, for their trauma-informed resilient schools online course that they offer. It's typically $200, but during this time they have provided that. So if educators are looking to equip themselves with some more tools and resources around social emotional, once we return to school, whether it's in the next few weeks or in the next few months, we are going to have some students who are going to need some support around various traumatic experiences that they may have had. And so I think that's really a great resource that we could utilize. I've already signed up for the course myself.
Oh, great.
And also, I think it's wonderful, too, for some families to engage in some life skills during this time. So really working with their students on things that they're very comfortable doing, maybe with is cooking or laundry. Some parents may feel some anxiety around the instruction, but when it comes to those day-to-day things that they do, that can help families to feel successful as they teach their kids those particular skills.
And how to play board games.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. I was gonna ask what advice or suggestions you have for educators who, you know, can't get in touch with all of their students for this extended period of time. You know, everybody kind of hurried out of my classroom on Friday, and I don't know when I'm going to see those students again. And, you know, as the person who is responsible for them most of the day, I have, you know, it's hard to think about them, and I hope they're in a safe place, and I, you know, hope they're getting food, and but I can't contact all of them. So do you have any tips for educators who, I see a lot of it on Facebook too, you know, we're worried about our students and their families, and we don't get to see them every day anymore.
I'm not sure who you were directing that question to, if it was for everybody, Micah.
yeah, everybody.
But as most of you know, I am a co-leader for a Girl Scout troop, and we're not having troop meetings right now. We're in the middle of working on certain badges, and I am putting a little package together to mail home to them. And so you might want to kick it old school and just get a pack of postcards and just, you know, write something nice, a little I'm thinking about you message, and just snail mail it to them, because you have access to their email, not their email, but their physical addresses in Power School.
That's a good suggestion.
We talked about just with our staff, maybe setting up an hour or 2 hours of a Zoom meeting that maybe school counselors, psychologists, social workers call in and they have questions about, you know, how to handle a situation or what's happening, or just giving feedback and setting up sort of like an office hour kind of thing. I don't know if that's an option, you know, for you as well, if you know email addresses and can set up just kind of a virtual, hey, I'm dropping in my office, come see me for an hour, you know, virtually, if that's an option. You know, we were kind of kicking around that idea as well.
Yeah. I just, you know, Durham saw a lot of students come in after Katrina. And I just think back to those teachers who that day, they had no idea where their students went. And I imagine some of our students might not come back just based on what, you know, they might be going to stay with extended family or something like that. I know I won't be able to contact all of my students electronically, you know, just based on the needs of my students. But I like the snail mail idea. And I think that would be something. And I think, I know NCAE has been having daily calls with educators to talk about some of these things. And, you know, there's a lot of sadness amongst a lot of teachers about what's going to happen to their students.
And yeah. Just a little tip, Micah, for your, if you decide to do the postcards, is type it up and put it on the labels. So that way you can just peel them and stick them to the postcards. So you're not having to write out all of them. It saves you a little bit of time.
Yeah. I know at the elementary level, and I'm thinking all levels could use it. We use Class Dojo.
Yes.
So all the teachers in my building have a Class Dojo account, and they've made me as the principal a co-teacher. So they can post messages, I can post messages. While we're out, I'm actually going to submit like little videos that will simulate my announcements a couple of times a week. So it kind of seems like we're still in school, even though we're not in school. So it's kind of like Principal Thomas keeping in touch. And so if you know, I don't know if you could do like a Class Dojo. If your students have emails, then, you know, it could be sent through their email. They accept the request, and then you can post messages and messages to them daily. It even translates.
I have Remind, you know, and I have Google Classroom. It's good, just this, I can't get it. There's never going to be during these 3+ weeks. I don't think I'll probably be able to contact everybody.
Everybody.
Right? Which of course is, you know, as their teacher, I don't want to not know where they are.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Because sometimes we can't contact, but they contact each other. So if you contact one, then you can ask them to maybe have that person tell the other one to contact you. And also, our counselor has asked the teachers to put a link for them when we send out our messages, in case they have, you know, a trauma or something, or somebody that they need to talk to. So just put the word out. They talk way more than what we do.
That's true. Well, any other thoughts before we wrap up this episode? I think we've had some great conversations and some great resources. And if individuals who are watching this program, if you have some resources that we can include in our description box, please feel free to reach out, and I'll gladly include those resources, because we want to make sure that teachers and students feel some level of comfort. I mean, this is unprecedented, uncertain times, but if we can all work together and really lean into one another and support each other, I know that we'll get through this.
Well, and I hear what you're saying, Micah, because we know that some of our students have some difficult living situations, and you know, we want to check on them and make sure that they're okay. And it is an unprecedented time, and it's really difficult to, as you mentioned before, I think about kids may not have access to the internet, and they may not have a laptop or a Chromebook, and so yeah, I get that. I worry about some of the kids that I know will have a tough time at home.
So true. Well, we will continue to monitor what's going on with COVID-19, and we'll continue to share resources so that our teachers and students feel supported. Amy and Caron, thank you both so very much for coming and joining us for this conversation. We really appreciate you lending your expertise to this conversation.
Thanks so much. And I do have a Twitter handle. It's NCSPA Prez, P-R-E-Z 2020.
Wonderful. All righty then. We would like for all of you to engage the Tar Heel Teachers on our social media platforms. Please follow us on Twitter. Our handle is at Tar Heel Teachers. Please follow us on Facebook and like our page, Tar Heel Teachers. Please subscribe to our YouTube channel. Visit our website, tarheelteachers.com. On all of our social media platforms, please use our hashtag Tar Heel Teachers so that we can find your comments. We would like to thank all of our panelists for being with us for this episode. Dia Collins-Thomas, thank you for being our special guest elementary school panelist. So great to see you. Cassandra Parsons, Micah Tweetmeyer, and Arisha Smalls. And once again, we would like to thank Dr. Amy Parker, who is the Director of Counseling Services for Gaston County Schools and the President of the North Carolina School Counsel Association, for joining us, as well as Caron Nowell, who is the President of the North Carolina School Psychology Association. Thank you both so very much. We look forward to seeing you all next time on Tar Heel Teachers at Home. Be safe out there. Thank you.